you ever get a chance to see it, you've seen that movie. Is that an amazing movie? That was filmed right around where we were in the Eagle Mountains. Okay, and we'll go ahead here, so.
There it is.
Okay. This is underneath the hooves of the camels as they were moving along. This was one of the plants that we're seeing, and it's a succulent, very closely related to Crassula. It's a genus called Rhodiola. And Rhodiola are found in the high mountains and on the seashores of the Arctic Sea in the Northern Hemisphere. There are dozens of species of Rhodiola, and almost all of them could be grown outdoors, especially in a container in Seattle, because these are actually cold-loving, moisture-loving succulents. You may not be aware of it, but a large number of Crassulas are actually moisture-loving plants. So there's a whole group of plants that you should probably be looking at. And this one's called Rhodiola quadrifida. It's an extremely high alpine plant that's endemic to the Altai Mountains. And we'll see a closer picture of it. These are two young specimens that I photographed. The other ones are far much larger, older specimens. But the genus Rhodiola is fantastically diversified, primarily in the Himalayas, and we'll be seeing some of those too. In addition to Crassulas, there are also sedums, or this has also been called, I think, Petrosedum now, but I still like the old term. This is Sedum hybridum, which is widely available in commerce. You can buy this mail order, you can buy it at their garden centers in Denver, sell this because it's an extremely good sedum. Here it is in the wild. This is in Kazakhstan, but we also saw it in Mongolia. You can see growing like most sedums do, right on top of a rock. And here's a close-up of the most universal of all rhodiolas. This is a Rhodiola rosea, and it has this funny name, rosea. Why is it rosea when the flower is yellow? Well, the answer is that the root smells like a rose. And it's called the rose root, and it's one of the most ancient plants in the European Materia Medica, because it's found all over Europe. It's found in Scandinavia, in England, on coastal areas in the Arctic, and then it's found in high mountains all over the world. This is a photograph I took in Mongolia where it's extremely abundant. And here's its close relative, Rhodiola algida, which is a white-flowered one, which is quite rare from Mongolia. But the thing about Rhodiola rosea is if you Google Rhodiola, you're going to see a ton of advertisements for an herb called Rhodiola, which is used widely for many, many purposes. In Russia, it's used by almost all the athletes use it because it's considered to be a strengthener. It's also used because it's supposedly it has certain enhancements of certain, at any rate, Rhodiola has many qualities. So if you Google Rhodiola, do try and use rosea or something specific, because otherwise it's going to be reams and reams and reams of people trying to sell you Rhodiola, which comes from these, which are harvested by the metric ton in the Arctic and in high mountain regions, and processed. And you'll see some pictures of those too. And this is one of the commonest sedums in the Altai Mountains. Now, these are plants that actually go through 40 to 50 below zero Fahrenheit. The Altai Mountains are exactly equidistant between the Indian and Arctic Oceans, the Atlantic and the Pacific Oceans. They are the most continental mountains on Earth, and they have recorded temperatures of 70 below zero in parts of the Altai. So these are plants that you don't have to worry about leaving outside in the cold. So that is a good quality, don't you think? And Sedum hybridum, by the way, is widely available in the trade. And it looks pretty much like it does in the wild. The real gem among succulents are the little, they call them sometimes the Chinese temples. Sometimes they're called dunce caps, which I detest. But these are the Oristachys, and the genus Oristachys is actually just a group of sedums that have rosettes that look more like hens and chicks. And they're primarily found in Japan, China, Korea, often at low elevations. There's a tremendous number of them. They thrive in your climate. They thrive in my climate. The one hint I should give you, if you ever get an Oris stack, is placid plates in a very shallow container. They love to be in shallow soil, in either a shallow pot or even on top of a rock. And in the wild, they usually almost always go on top of rocks. Here it is in bloom from Mongolia. It's about to be a joke on our trip. I've been to Mongolia and to Kazakhstan twice. Every time we stopped, it didn't matter if it was desert, steppe, montane, woodlands, subalpine or alpine, it was always there. And we always would joke. And go ahead and you'll see some more pictures of it.
Actually, a question. What's that other plant? It looks like it's a bromelia.
That color over there, I believe that's what's called a euphrasia. Euphrasias are semi-parasitic plants that are now in, I'm trying to remember, St. Thomas Castellia. And here's a close-up showing you the rosette of Oristachys spinosa. This is the form that grows in the Mongolia, more green. If you buy this commercially, you usually get a grayer form, which I think is even prettier. So you can get this. And we grow lots of, and this is just a typical habitat. It's a shallow gravelly soil, and there are literally thousands of them. You could walk on them for acres. And there's got to be, I can't even imagine, how many of these are growing in Mongolia and in the Altai. That is the highest peak in Mongolia, and it's very deceptive. That is the Bokhtan Glacier is coming down, and one of my colleagues, we hiked up there. This is well above tree line, and some of you may have heard of him. Mike Bone, he's an associate director of horticulture at Denver Botanic Gardens. He has a long beard, he looks like ZZ Top. He was with me on this trip. This is 10 years ago, he was much younger. I can kind of forgive him. But he's a pretty cool guy. Actually, he's just come back from Argentina. And he saw that glacier, and the next thing we knew, he was off. And I was like, bye, where are you going? And we went off. It took him 3 hours to get there. It took all day. And everybody left, and I waited. And we didn't get back till after dark. He was not a happy camper. I wasn't when he came back. But he got to the glacier and he had a good time. So that just shows you how vast the distance is. We're in Mongolia here, but that ridge top there is Russia. So, you know, there was a vice presidential candidate who once said that she could see Russia from her porch. Well, I could see it from where I was sitting. I could see Russia. And I've seen Russia several times from a distance. And then now we're going to go to the Tian Shan. That's in the southern part of Kazakhstan, is the Tian Shan. And Tian Shan is a very different mountain range from the Altai. The Altai is a lot more like the Rockies. It's much colder. It's the flora has a tremendous number of parallels to Colorado in particular. The Tian Shan has much more of a Mediterranean flavor, and it is utterly magnificent. And here's that was our guide. His name was Vladimir Korbinsa, and he's looking at a little plant. It's not technically it's not a succulent. It's actually in the same family as Dianthus, the Caryophyllaceae. It's called Calycospermum cephalosum. That plant there, it could be 200 or 300 years old. I've seen pictures. If you look up Calycospermum, you'll see pictures in the Himalayas of some that are like a meter across that have to be, thousands of years old. And it's one of the most high alpine wall plants. And here's a close up. The flowers are smaller than a pinhead. They're very, very tiny. And not technically a succulent, I suppose, but I don't think there's anybody who's a succulent lover who couldn't enjoy that plant. It's one of the coolest plants on Earth. And it has been going successfully in Europe. I've never succeeded in germinating it, but someday I'd love to. It's actually widespread in the Himalayas and in the Tian Shan Mountains. And this is a plant in the bleeding heart family called Cisco corydalis or corydalis vercenkoi. And it has very succulent leaves. So it's not technically a succulent, but it's an honorary succulent. Because it has leaves that are very, very succulent. And Vladimir had seen this colony for many years. And this was the very first year that he'd seen flowers on it. Because it grows in an area where the snow lingers and it doesn't have the time, perhaps, to develop enough carbohydrate reserves. But this year, Blum, of course, he left his camera behind. He's been up there so many times that I don't need to take my camera. I have to take pictures for it. But it's one of the most beautiful plants. And the Bleeding Heart family, the genus Corylus, by the way, has hundreds and hundreds of species in Eurasia, especially in the Himalayas. And I've had a pleasure to see them. But the real gem of that one I had to share with you is a plant that's sort of ancestral to columbines. It's called Paraplegia. This is the very first time I've seen it. I've seen it since then many times in the Himalayas, but seeing it 10 years ago, it was these incredibly gorgeous flowers, always growing in a crevice. Very, very high up in the mountains there. So this is a little diversion. I have to show you a few non-succulents. Just so it's like changing your palate, cleansing your palate with a sorbet. Right? So now let's move on. Aha! Back to the rhodiolas. So you remember you've seen a yellow one, you've seen one that's kind of yellow and orange, and now this species is a true orange one. This is an alpine species or subalpine that's widespread in the Tian Shan Mountains called Rhodiola linearifolia. And it turns out we've been able to grow it successfully in Denver, and I'm quite sure it can grow even better than you. So I keep a lookout if you have a chance to grow some of these rhodiolas, because I think this is a group of succulents. You know, like I said, basically what they are is alpine, cold, moisture-loving crassulas. And one of the gems from the Tian Shan, endemic to the High Tian Shan, is Rhodiola coccinea, which I don't think has ever been cultivated. It's pretty widespread. The Tian Shan is a massive mountain range. It's at least 1,000 miles long. It's shared by China, Kyrgyzstan, Kazakhstan, and a little piece of it goes into Uzbekistan. So it's a massive mountain range, and this plant I think is found along the entire crest of this massive mountain range. Accidentally, while I was looking at there, I stumbled on this Roscularia. Roscularia is a genus of succulents in the Crassulaceae that are related to sedum. Actually, they have been sometimes called sedum, but it's essentially a subgenus of sedum. And there are dozens of species of Roscularia that extend from Greece and Turkey all the way across Central Asia. These are the true steppe plants. And these grow particularly well for us in Denver. For you, they're going to be a little trickier perhaps because they usually grow in drier regions, although this is a true alpine, so you could probably grow this. You grow alpine plants quite well. And now we find ourselves in Tibet. And I was very privileged 3 years ago to have an expedition that went from Lijiang in northern China to Tibet. It was about 1,200 miles. And who on earth is going to go to Tibet for succulents? Well, I did, and I found a lot of them. So let's take a look at what we found. The queen of succulents in China is in Tibet is undoubtedly this rhodiola called Rhodiola perennulata. Tibet has dozens and dozens of rhodiolas, but in my opinion, this is the most beautiful of them all, and it's also one of the most abundant. I saw this many passes. Usually, it's about 14,000 feet, but I've seen it up to almost 17,000 feet. I'm lucky to get up quite high, and isn't that a lovely thing? Wouldn't that look lovely in one of your pots?
Yeah.
And you could probably grow it quite well, it's not in cultivation. Even though it's an extremely widespread plant that grows over tens of thousands of acres of Tibet. Nobody's ever bothered. And it's being sold, here it is, in a Chinese herbal shop. And those are all, that is Rhodiola perennulata. And look at the rhizomes. And I would have loved to have bought a bunch of those rhizomes because I have a hunch they were probably living.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, there are certain problems with importing rhizomes to the United States. We did not have permits, so you can grind those up. And these are just various other rhodiolas I was lucky enough to see while I was in Tibet. I think that one is related to Fustigiata, but I don't know if there's any of these. Those are those primroses and a little sandboard. Here's Rhodiola dumulosa. That's from about 14,000 feet of Hongshan Pass in China on the way to Tibet. That's another close-up of Demulosa. So, and this one is very similar to Quadrupeda, but it's not Quadrupeda. I don't know which one this is. I've been very fortunate. Like I said, I broke 1,200 miles for Tibet. We went over five or six passes, all of them above 15,000 feet. I got all of them, so I was able to take all these pictures. And unfortunately, there's no little guidebook on the rhodiolas of Tibet that I could refer to. I would have loved to be able to name them all, but I'm working on it. Yes?
I'm curious, what kind of rock do you think that is that they're all
growing here? Tibet has, on the trip, we went through a lot of granite. This, I think, is a metamorphic rock, possibly. I'm not 100% sure. But they also have limestone. The Himalayas are incredibly complex and rich in geomorphology, and so I can't tell you necessarily any given picture. But that to me strikes me as, I'm pretty sure that's sort of semi-morphic. We have some geologists in the audience who might be able to help.
That is a jacket.
Looks a little bit like a schist or something, right?
What's
that? That makes sense. I know they have lots of quartz, but that makes sense. It's hard to say without actually chipping it in the character. But they have all kinds of rocks, and of course, the paths very much depend on the rock, because for example, one of my favorite passes is called Bai Ma Shan, and if you go on my blog right now, called Crazy Lake, I've been posting pictures from my trip that I took a few years ago to China that I neglected, because I took so many pictures on this one mountain pass that I've never posted, so now I'm posting them. I have at least three or four blog posts, each with dozens and dozens of pictures from just one pass in northern Yunnan, called Bai Ma Shan. But more rhodiolas, heaven only knows what species. Another species, I'm not sure what it was. And this one is definitely Pasigiato. And another one I never could figure, growing with the primrose, you can see. You don't think of succulents growing with primroses and all these moisture-loving plants, but the Himalayas are pretty moist. They get the monsoon. And here's Rhodiola nobilis, that was one of the So here's a huge genus of plants that come from high mountains. And how many of these have you seen in a succulent book or any other book? And the answer is probably not very many, maybe Rhodiola rosea, which I believe grows in Washington State.
We have integrifolia. In the contiguous United States, rosea grows in the shorelands of Maine. That's how far south it goes on the Atlantic coast. And there are some disjunct populations in the highest peaks in Tennessee, out of all places. But in Washington, we have integrifolia, which goes from, I think, from like Colorado to Alaska. Have you seen the Washington integrifolias?
I
don't recall what the flowers were looked like, but the foliage and the rhizomes of the Washington ones are very different from rosea.
Okay, that's good to know. At any rate, as you can see, lots of more. You have some in your own backyard. Recently is actually Adludens I think for the town of Adunza, which is now called, in China the new name for it is not Adunza, it's not. It's the northernmost town in Yunnan. And it's not Shangri-La, it's called the Chen. But the old name for the Chen was Adunza, and that's named for that town, Rhodiola Adunzensis. And yet another one, and on, so we can just keep going. These are some growing on top of a fence in a little town in Yunnan, on top of a wall. So, Tibet is a pretty unlikely place to go for succulents, but how much less likely is it to go to Sweden? A few years ago, Jan and I went to Sweden. She bought a new Volvo in Sweden. And so the next couple of pictures are some plants from Northern Europe from the trip there. And this is at Gothenburg Botanical Garden. And this is a conservatory which was just gutted and totally redone last year. So you're going to see what it looked like about 2015 when we were there. And this is a little sculpture they have at the entrance of their succulent conservatory. And you can see they're having some fun with succulents at Gothenburg. In my opinion, Gothenburg is one of probably the two or three greatest public gardens in the world. So if you ever go to Sweden, make sure you go to Gothenburg. It's unbelievable. Their second collection is just one greenhouse, but it's very, very nice. But they have phenomenal collections of trees, rhododendrons, alpines, perennials, bulbs, especially bulbs. It's probably the best collection of bulbs in the world. And there's a little monanthus. I thought that was very cute the way they use the entrance just to get people's attention. Of course, none of this exists anymore because they totally gutted this last year. And I've not seen what the new one looks like. This is when it was fairly fresh. It had been designed by a friend of mine named Peter Korn, did the rock work, and it's using reddish stone to look like the American Southwest. Again, these are all historical slides because it's not like that anymore. And lots of interpretation, lots of education. Every public garden in Europe has major succulent collections. And even though this is not the major focus of Gothenburg, they have a wonderful collection. Everything is, of course, impeccably labeled. They're beautiful specimens. Mentions bed after bed. These are some of the African beds. You saw there's beds with American native plants. And that's Mats Hallborg. He's one of the assistant directors of Gothenburg. He was taking us in the Gothenburg Succulent Society. We're doing a tour of the greenhouses, and I spoke to them. So I just spoke to them. Here you can see some big South African mesons of various kinds. This is one of their South African beds. Very meticulously labeled, beautifully staged, but apparently not good enough because they've just got it and everything off. Yeah, I took a picture of this Pelargonium bocoracus. It's one I'm interested in because it grew in an area of South Africa when it comes to research. And here's a bunch of little South American Soto rubidias and rubidias in full bloom, Rubidia pygmaea, which has been overwintered in Colorado. It's a very high alpine Andean. Not by me, but by a friend of mine in Colorado Springs. And some North American cacti here. So just to give you a taste of what one botanic garden in Sweden has done with our plants, they've done a pretty nice job, I think. You can see a nice floriferous mass on that. But Germany is really, in many places, in many ways, the mecca. If you really into the cultivation of succulents, you can't go wrong. Germany is exactly half the size of Texas. In other words, you could fit two Germanys in one Texas. The difference is that Texas has 43 million people, which is an awful lot of people, but Germany has 80 million people. And it has 150 botanic gardens. In other words, you can't really swing I don't want to say which kind of an animal, without getting a botanic garden pretty much in Germany, because every city has almost one or sometimes two or three botanic gardens, and they're fantastic. So we're going to start out looking at two of them, one of the Darmstadt, and then the other is at Frankfurt am Main. Those are two of the places we visited. Jan claims we visited about 85 botanic gardens. I know there was only 12. But we did visit 12, so we only saw a fraction. So we have to go back. She has to buy at least three or four more bulbs. And this is the director of the Darmstadt Botanic Garden. His name is Schneckenberger. And he's showing us around. Notice that the little lawn there is full of dandelions. I always thought the Germans were like the super meticulous, fussy. They love dandelions. All their lawns are full of dandelions.
But they're native there.
This, my friend, unfortunately died 2 years ago of cancer, but he was the one showing us around. And that's a rock garden they have dedicated to succulents of mostly North America, and they just planted a bunch of five plants that were collected 150 years ago by Perkins, who was, had a brother who was a gardener, so he'd send that plants back. So any plant is called Perkinsia. So the applicants that were collected by Perkins 150 years ago, they still have the plants growing there. So this is, there you can see Carl Albert Perkins. He sent him to his brother, Joseph Anton Perkins. So there was this relationship between these two brothers that introduced many, many plants to cultivation from Mexico and southwestern United States a very, very long time ago. And these are some of the plants that are growing now in their native American bed. That's a photograph of Persia tridentata, which is the widespread rosaceous shrub in the American West. And it was really hurting when I saw it there because I realized we didn't grow it at Denver Botanic Gardens yet. I had to go to Germany to find the shrub that grows behind, you know, the Denver and the mountains. And there's a little close-up. That's Persia tridentata and growing. And these are in their greenhouses. In their cold frames, they grow all sorts of unusual and alpine plants and just rare plants. So it's fun to look in their cold frames. And here's a really nice calceolaria from South America. And there's a Fabiana, which is in the tobacco family from South America. Really nice. And there's my friend showing me around his cactus greenhouse, where they have a nice collection of cycads, very sensitive artos. You can see some nice big golden barrels. And this, you can just keep moving right ahead. And wonderful ingredients that were in full bloom and weather there was quite spectacular. Lots of other goodies while we were there.
What is?
Like I said, almost every botanic garden we went to had some wonderful blue panel. Here's you can see the they had some lovely specimens of Wichia. And I photographed them in the daytime and then tried to capture them at night. We were there for a couple of days, so we had fun trying to pick up some. And they were fruiting pretty well there. Every botanic garden we went to had spectacular Wichias. We have some miserable little specimens in Denver, but someday we'll have some good ones. And then, of course, the Syringia acquiescens, which I think mine's even better than that, actually. And I got a beautiful specimen from Pete today.
You should see Georges.
A collection where they're germinating various kinds of plants and different techniques, and I thought they were germinating some water plants in these little sponges on top of water, which is kind of fun. This is another one of the greenhouses. Just more and more pictures from their the Darmstadt Botanic Garden. Now, this is not a major botanic garden. This is kind of a provincial small one. But look at all the collections that he has. Just rack upon rack, mile upon mile, just incredible specimens. And they're layered in the greenhouse on the side there. It's all the good side. And you have the Gaudium bloom while we're there.
Okay, yes. Are a lot of those field collected?
Oh yeah, now, everything in Germany, all of the botanic gardens have curators of succulent plants, and they all meet once a year, and they have a week-long meeting where they're constantly discussing their collections, identifying plants, and everything has to be wild collected, everything has to have data, and everything has to be duplicated. This is their Kalanchoe collection, and he hated it, because you know what Kalanchoe is, don't you? And they had to try and keep them all separate. I'll let them get one of the visits. Would you like to get a Kalanchoe collection from us? At any rate, but they're obligated to take care of all sorts of obscure groups of plants as part of being part of this larger thing, so they're all identified.
Yeah, well, somebody has to like Kalanchoe. It has over 100 species.
Exactly. And they have most of them there. So here we are. We're going to take a look now at two places in Bavaria. One is in the town of Kirchen, and this is the private garden of the largest hardy cactus nursery in the world. And it's in the town of Kirchen, which is on the border of Swabia and of Bavaria. And this is one of his vehicles. You can see Kaktian Garden is the name of his business of Kirchen. Hardy cactus, you can see it's a hardy cactus because the saguaro is in the arms of a snowman, right? So it's got to be hardy. Winter hardy, you can see. And there he is showing off one of his several times. He's coming back next month. We're going to have a big party when he arrives. And he hosted us there on the Mother's Day weekend, which is the busiest weekend for garden centers in the world. And especially in Germany, they're really hard on it. But he had all of his crew doing all his work for him. He took 3 days off and hosted Jan and me in wonderful style. And these are his influences. That's his website, and you can find it. He has a fantastic website, kaptangarden.de. And these are, but he grows more than that. These are some Western American instruments. He grows lots of American wildflowers. He's really passionately in love with America. He comes here every couple of years. He grows American plants. These are some of his rock gardens with ice plants and sedums. And hens and chicks, as you can see, he has a few of them. That's pretty, it's not real. In case you're worried about there, he's kind of creatures. So these are just some glimpses of his private garden and his nursery. And of course, it's Mother's Day, so what do? You buy your mother a watering can full of succulents. That's the thing you do. And these are just a glimpse of a small number he has. Many, many greenhouses in three different villages in Bavaria and also in Swabia. And these are just some of the plants. This is the last picture is of Oristachys. You saw Oristachys spinosa from in the Altai. This is a bread form. And he sent it to me two times, and I put them together. The third time I finally embroidered it. This is the third time I got it. There's just flats and flats of ice plants and hens and chicks. Those are all, that's Delisperma congestum on the right-hand side, which I helped introduce to cultivation, the white form. And this is a rare one named for Sean Hogan, who's going to be coming to your club, I hope, one day. And Sean Hogan discovered that in South Africa in the 1990s, and I've maintained it in cultivation, and they're growing it like a weed in Germany. Just look at those damn things. On and on it goes, and this is just one of his nurseries, mind you. And he complained bitterly, said it was a horrible litter, he had tremendous damage and problems. I never saw a plant that wasn't perfect. I mean, everything in the nursery was fantastic. And I had to show you this. He named the form of Triglycerides enormis after me. And he had a tissue culture and it was sold for a while. And I think I have the only one in North America, and maybe the only one in the world for all I know right now. Here he has a nice pediococcus when we were there at the right time. So just more pictures of Hans and what he's up.